My full name is Catherine Black. My job title really is caregiver. You know, I'm Gina's 24/7 caregiver. It's something that you end up being the one-on-one. Gina's 33 years old. Yeah, well, you know, you create a being, and this being, somebody has to take responsibility for. Gina's father took off when Gina was born. And, you know, it is what it is. And so I've had a path with having to deal with Gina through relationships, through jobs, through crisis. I've been through not wanting to give her any medication, to having to give her medication, to having her being over-medicated, put in a facility for a week, going through super trauma, and having to reorient her into a structured lifestyle where she's doing appropriate behaviors in public and not an adult person going into meltdowns that scares everybody around her because they don't know her. And this is what leads to harm. So the thing that was shared with me in the beginning, we're going to do behavior modification. What's that mean? Behavior modification. And, you know, it's like toys in the car. And so I really needed for it to be more hands-on, and it wasn't. So now I'm the person that has the hands-on, you know, lead, follow, or get out of the way is my motto. You know, if you've got a good plan, I'm going with your plan. If you don't have a plan, I'm going to think of a plan. And that's how you work it, because sometimes if you let the person that doesn't have the insight lead, whoever it may be, your child, your spouse, or, you know, if you let them lead and they really don't have the path clear, it's going to harm everyone. You know, I'm 33. You know what I'm watching out for now? My daughter in the gym. I take her to the gym. She loves shaved heads. So she'll walk by somebody working out and touch their head. I have to say, excuse me, she's autistic. Gina, this is not appropriate. You don't touch them. Sorry. So, you know, still 33. And they're like, oh, that's cool. I got a brother. I got a cousin. You know, so you have to get them in public. And now she's, you know, she's looking for me. Where is she in the gym? But I'm watching her and, you know, just constant, you know, so it doesn't end. You know, so you try to make it a relationship that works instead of, which is difficult because it's a lot of times it's a negative, hard, you know, deal. When I did let go of my daughter and let her go to a group home, which everybody was all about, all girls, I visited her every week, and from a distance, I saw her behavior easier than when I lived with her every day, because every day was just like, every day, crazy. You know, breakfast, lunch, dinner. So it gave space, and she spiraled down, but I did get to see her behaviors. And the first thing that, you know, I learned, she learned to communicate. She loved me, and she wanted to be with me, but she didn't, you know, it was a party, sleepover. She didn't know it was going to be full time. And so whenever she saw me, which was every Sunday, she'd say, what day, you know? And so I realized she was waiting till the next day to see me. And so that was a little turned me around a little bit, made me, you know, feel a little more responsible. And, you know, it's not 18, they're gone, you know, there's still your kid forever. And I was like, oh my God. So that was the most impactful when I realized how much she needed me. My sister said that having my daughter with her on vacation was like living with a mirror. Living with a mirror. Because if you start getting up in the morning yelling and screaming, I guarantee you they're going to go into a meltdown. If you get up and you pretend everything is okay, and you try to be happy, and you put on a happy face, and you put on your music or something, you can change the whole thing, and you gotta fake it till you make it. And so with Gina, that whole premise of your behavior and their behavior and helping get past this, fake it. It's a pain in the neck, but set it up, right? You set it up for success. And so that's what I tried to do, is just, you know what reality is. You know what you're dealing with. We don't have to pretend, but we need to pretend the outcome. And so with Gina, I am pretending the outcome. Now I'm 33 years into this. What am I manifesting now? What do I want next for her? What am I pretending? I don't know. She's making pizza dough at Easter Seals. And I thought, wow, my son-in-law runs Domino's. Can I put the two together? Gotta make it happen, because you know what? What's always going to happen? I don't want to go to work. I don't want to do this. I don't want to go to school. I'm tired. I don't want to get up. And those little things just wear you down. And so you have to dismiss them. It's just like my daughter. My daughter would want to attack me. And we'd have to say, no, love your mommy. Be nice to your mommy. Be kind to your mommy. It's a shame we had to say it, but we had to plant the thoughts of love, because in her was like just her, just me. I want this, I want that. I could tell you stories that would make your skin crawl. Toilet water taste testing. Your kid has stuck her finger in so many toilets and in her mouth, or gum underneath the tables in her mouth. She's not dead. You know, she didn't die of a disease, Ebola. She's fine. Licked the ground, licked mold. Disgusting. Anyway, it passes. Everybody's good. You know, people are very judgmental. Oh, they're very judgmental. I mean, we all are. You know, and it's about stepping back for a moment, you know, and just catching that breath, stopping yourself, because you save yourself a lot of times. Yesterday out in a parking lot, in a store, and there was this big boy, man, your age maybe, got out of a Hummer, big shot, Hummer, and cussing like a sailor. So I look over and I'm thinking developmental problems, and he zeroes in on me. And so we're walking to the store and he's got this girl with him and she's going, you're too much drama, calm down. So he's zeroed in on me. So I had to just calm down and just go through my shopping thing. And we passed each other in the store a few times and he was that woman, blah, 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 you know, nasty. So I just had to stay calm, and I couldn't immediately leave because he wasn't processing the situation correctly, be he developmentally disabled or not. He was over the edge, inappropriate, in public. And hit this girl that was with him, she was trying to calm him down. So I just try to stay calm, because part of you wants to be like, hey, what's your problem? You know, you want to address it, you know, like you think you're going to communicate. I'm from the East Coast. This is how we communicate. But it's not. Communication is many different levels. And so I think taking that moment, me included, stepping back and saying, okay, let me not counterattack this person who's attacking. Let me not show the same thing. You know, let me try to resonate different. You know, let me be conscious. He may not be conscious. He may just be off on an emotional boom. But I have to be conscious. I think to provide the best service would to be to realize that they are the case management. They are not the case authority. And this has been a problem because as a parent, I have to fall within the guidelines of the government. And sometimes the government is a form. And you have to comply with forms. And okay, all right. But it takes a long time to get a return from that. And so for me, I think they need to remember that they're working for us, to unify us, to help us, not to maintain their job, not to, you know, because sometimes there's so many workers that I've been through, I get angry because they're scrutinizing my life and my daughter, and they're making their salaries, and they're not realizing that she does need these services. And you know, it's a rough ball to juggle, because you know they're government, but we are the government. And so that has been my little bit of struggle, because until I got to where Gina was when she was out of school, that's when it becomes a really rough for the parent, because when they're in school, the schools are like, oh yeah, we'll put her here and you'll do this and da da da, and that's great, right? And we got a speech therapist coming in. You don't get to see it. You take their word for it. You know, I've had trouble with schools because sometimes it's not what you think it is. And so some have been really good, really great people, helped me a whole lot, you know. But once they get out of school, then you're with government workers. And you're still taking care of these people. And they have new programs that they're introducing, but it puts the burden on the parents. Now these children are growing, the situation is growing, and the parents are having to figure it out without school. Okay, you don't have eight to four. How do you make a living? We need case management help, not people that are authoritarians in their position, or I am this and I am this and she is this. I don't care. You know, to me, you're Lucy and Mary and Betty, you're people with me. And you know, they want to get these people in inclusion in the community. You need training for positions and things and vocations. And if you don't provide training, these people end up on the streets. They end up talking to themselves, beating themselves. People are afraid of them, attacking people, no medication, sick. You need training centers. I was on Kauai for a couple of years. Kauai, they shouldn't let anybody even come there anymore. They're not receptive. And so we were without even a day program for over 2 years. And we flew to Maui. I was like, this is ridiculous. I mean, I was known probably on the island far and wide because I'm very outspoken. We got on a plane, we came to Maui, and they said, sure, we have room for her. And so we flew out in 8 weeks, everything, house, job, everything, move, we got over here. And she's been involved in Easter Seals. They're wonderful over here in Maui. Roxanne Kehas is the administrator working with the Easter Seals program. That's how I got connected up. And she's trying to help me and others get involved in different types of meetings around town and to be more proactive, because, you know, I have a lot of energy and, but I'm one person. And so I'm trying to hook up. It's been difficult just to, you know, get your life together. I have maybe 3 hours till Gina's back home, and then we have to, she just consumes all my energy, and I have to constantly entertain, redirect. And I'm hoping, as time goes by, to be more engaged with this type of thing. That's why I reached out. Yes, I'll do this. Yes, I'll meet Thursday with the group. I went to Easter Seals and I did 2 volunteer classes where we made crystal rainbow hangings. I was thinking maybe the people at Easter Seals could make them, and then they could... they're being featured at Nita's Attic. I hooked up with one of the consignment shops, and she's going to do a whole wall in July with everybody doing a rainbow hanging and a little vignette about them. This is Scott. Scott is 32 years old. He enjoys water sports and, you know, ninja games or whatever, you know. And so they're going to make a little, and they get to go visit, and she's going to promote Easter Seals with the... So I'm trying to do my little thing, you know, in there. And, you know, it's out of the box again. You know, it took a lot to go in. There's like 20 people there. And they had 3 care workers and me, and we were all running around, and it's just driftwood and crystals and string. But we were all running around. Everybody's like trying to hold the crystal real careful. So it was very intimate, and I loved it. And so I did it twice, hooked it up with a Kihei Beach consignment shop. And Maui is just so cool like that. Everybody wants more of that. So if you could supply it, they want it.